glad you're here with us this morning. It's a blessing to have you all here. Welcome into the house of the Lord this morning. I spend a lot of my days, as most of you know, because I talk about it frequently, listening to some programs. One of them is focused on the family. And I heard a message this week that I just want to share with you because it resonated in my heart so much with what's been going on in our own church and how a lot of it has been playing out, and it's so encouraging to see. I was introduced this week through a message to a lady and her son, Emily and Max Coulson. And Max is an autistic child, communicative, but very much a child trapped in a teenager's body. And his mother for a long time struggled with what to do with him at church, because they would go to church and he would be disruptive and he would be in the back singing in the middle of the message, or he would be jumping up and down. So they stayed alone. They stayed away for a long time. And then she started trying to find a way, because Max wanted to go to church, to get him there. So they would go before church for coffee time, they would go home during church, and then they would come back. And they had church in a much like our auditorium or our gymnasium, so they had to set chairs up every week and take them down after the service. And Max quickly became very interested in putting chairs away. So one day they were putting chairs away, and this man from the church came over and he laid his hand on Max's shoulder and he said, "Max, I think you would be a real asset to the group." That is what they called the crew that put the chairs away and set up. They called it the grunt crew. Some weeks later, they came to that same church again, and they decided to stay in the service. And as Emily will tell you in the story that she tells, this story about this lady that she is part of, there was a lady beside them who kept turning around to her and saying, "You don't belong." And all through the service, she turned around and she kept looking at Max and Emily. And there was another friend with them who had an autistic child, and this lady kept turning around and telling them that they weren't, well, they didn't belong. The service went on and they got to the end. They were singing their last song. And Max was singing at the top of his lungs because he knew the song, and he was dancing up and down. The next week they came back, and the same lady kept peeking over her shoulder. And I forget the exact words, but it was something like the pastor said, "Praise the Lord." And Max stood up in the middle of the service and threw his hands in the air and shouted with all his enthusiasm, "Praise the Lord." And this went on through that service to the point where the pastor was in tears and laughing, not at Max, but he was just overcome with joy with the enthusiasm that Max was raising God. The short version, because I need to cut this down, is this lady who had told them for weeks that they didn't belong came up after that service and put her arms around Max and gave him a hug and thanked him for coming and told him that he was welcome. She goes on to tell the story in Matthew 20, where Jesus was leaving Jericho and he was walking down the street, and there were two blind men beside the road. They were screaming for him to come and see them. And while the crowd was urging Jesus, and screamed, yelled at him all the louder, and he went over and he entered the world and he healed him. And he just took the time to be with him. And the last thing she shared was from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 18 to 22. God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again to the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. I just want to leave that with you this morning. Parts of the body that are weak are indispensable. So I guess I'll end with this for our call to worship this morning. And it's simply this, John 3:16. For God so loved the world. And each and every one of you. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we're thankful for another day to be in your house and in your presence. We're thankful for the body of Christ that you have gathered here at Hartland Baptist Church. And as we look around, Father, we're just so thankful for each and every one. Father, may we just love with that same love that you have for us. Father, as we come into our service today, we just ask that you would open our hearts and minds, open our eyes to see you. Father, open our hearts to receive you. As we lift up our praises to you this morning, may it just be honoring and pleasing to you. Just bless us in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Let us stand together as we sing a few carols this morning.
it's really great to have you with this, as I mentioned before, to say it again and again and every time. We thank you for accepting God's call to minister with us, and we thank you for your personal testimonies and your ministry. And this is just a tiny token, this $2 to spend everywhere for a Christmas gift from the entire church family. Thank you so much. God bless you and your family.
Please stay in this call.
down, I'll invite the Tricarton family to come and light the Advent.
Times of joy and in our times of sorrow.
Your church is a fantastic and wonderful place. And we are grateful for our little church here in this great planet that we live on. We are blessed to be part of the lives of each other. And we thank you for our church. Lord, we pray that many will come on Tuesday evening to the Christmas Eve service as we just kick off the season, or finish it off, I guess, if in a way, in a wonderful way, in just worshiping Jesus Christ. Pray that many would feel welcome to come into our church and hear the gospel, we pray. I pray, Father, for the work that we do here together as a church, all the different things and activities that happen so that we can proclaim Jesus Christ to this community. And we pray that you would bless our work and our efforts for the glory of God, that the kingdom of God would be built right here in Hartland Baptist Church. We pray also for our sister churches, all in this area, who are also doing the same work of building the kingdom of God. We pray your blessing upon every single church where Christ is proclaimed. Thank you that we can come to the Word of God now. Lord, just pray that you would open our hearts and minds to be blessed by God as we read of your wonderful grace to us in the scriptures today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, today we are looking in the Gospel of John chapter 1. It's a very familiar text for many of us, and it's a wonderful text indeed. And we're going to take a few moments to look through just a small snippet of what is here in this passage today. John chapter 1, beginning right at the very beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were created through him, and apart from him, not one thing was created that has been created. Life was in him, and that life was the light of men. That light shines in the darkness, yet the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man named John who was sent from God. He came as a witness to testify about the light, so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but he came to testify about the light. The true light who gives light to everyone was coming to the world. He was in the world, and the world was created through him, yet the world did not recognize him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, he gave them the right to be children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. The Word became flesh and took up residence among us. We observed his glory, the glory as the one and only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified concerning him and exclaimed, "This is the one of whom I said, the one the one coming after me has surpassed me because he existed before me. Indeed, we have all received grace after grace, from his fullness, for the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only Son, the one and only Son, the one who is at the Father's side. He has revealed him." And we'll stop there today. Pastor Randy Nappy tells a story of a Sabbath time that he had taken from his church, and he was struggling with disappointments and struggles within the church, and he was contemplating his call to ministry and his call to that particular church and wondering if there was greener pastures somewhere else. And he happened to be walking by a cow pasture and stopped to gaze over the fence. And pondering the greener pastures, you might say, that he imagined God
might be leading him to, his attention was drawn down to a big, round, flat, dried-out cow pie. Lovely sight, he said. But right smack in the middle of that pile of dung was a single, beautiful flower. It was blooming and doing its best to grow as God had designed that little flower to grow. Even though it was surrounded by a foul-smelling stench and a horrid mess. The contrast between the beauty of the flower and the stench of its surrounding was powerful to Pastor Randy. And yet somehow God gave that flower the ability to bloom where it had been planted. Obviously, the seed was there before the cow made its deposit, and the flower had to push its way up and through the muck. But it eventually did, and it brought forth great beauty in that cow pie. On looking around further, he spotted several more flowers trying to grow in the middle of cow poop. I thought, you know, there are the precious souls in my church who know all about the stink and cow piles in their own lives, and they even know who is responsible sometimes for those deposits and can do absolutely nothing to change life circumstances. And yet, we bloom. In spite of our surroundings and in spite of the overwhelming stench surrounding them, those flowers bloom in the middle of those cow piles. And then Pastor Randy wrote, sometimes our lives can seem like that, doing our best to bloom where we're planted, to grow in spite of the stiff heap upon us and the stench that overpowers our best efforts to make the world a better smelling place. Yet bloom we do, because the power of God is life, isn't it? The power of God is life. Jesus is the life giver, the life sustainer, and he is the one who enhances and blesses our lives. So let me ask you this morning, why do we overcome in the midst of life's cow pies? We do so because Jesus showed us how to do it. Our text tells us that the Word was in the beginning with God, and that the Word was God. And later on in our text it says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Clearly the Word then is Jesus Christ. Clearly the Word is God Almighty. Don't be deceived by some groups who come up to your door and say that it's the translation is, in the beginning the Word was a God. It's not a God. It is not there in the original language. They've put it in there to suit their theological purposes. It does not hold up in under scrutiny. The little word a cannot be found in the original Greek. The Word was God. And this passage is tough to look at and not consider the Genesis account, the very first chapter in the book of the Bible. Right in verse 1, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So there is no question who then is the creator of the universe. Now, how he did it is still a mystery. So let's not get dogmatic about issues about that. The fact is that the universe came into being by the simple word of God Almighty. In our text in John, it says the Word was with God and the Word was God. And John says in verse 14, the Word became flesh and took up his residence among us. When God, Jesus, created all things, he declared it to be very good. Not just good, but very good. There was no mosquitoes. In the garden, God walked amongst humanity. And humanity knew God face to face. I can't imagine what a blessing that would have been. But something happened. A cow pie came along. Sin entered the world. And God caused this now fallen world, and in the cursed this now fallen world, and in the midst of this cow pile we call life, Jesus entered in. The God of heaven left his glory above, his perfection, to reside amongst us in this cow pie of life, to deliver us from our sins so he can bring forth and be that flower in our lives. Jesus gave us an example as how to bloom where we are planted. We know Jesus went through an awful lot in this life. John tells us that Jesus came to his own people, who were the Jews, and they rejected him. As we think about the history of the Jewish people, there is not a time in their history where they weren't disobedient to the prophets and rejected the prophets and punished the prophets. And eventually it led them to reject the Messiah as well. I know we often look at the Bible stories and we forget the impact of some of the words, and we look past the obvious because we're so familiar with it, and we just look at the rest of the story and we forget. Look at the rejection and maybe in Jesus' face. Jesus came to his own people, the people who created, that he chose so graciously, and they turned their backs on him and nailed him to a cross. Now, besides the physical pain, remember, Jesus had emotions, just like you and I. I can only imagine the rejection of his people broke his heart. We don't look at that. We pass by it. Can you imagine the pain in his heart? And Jesus lived his life in one big cow pie of rejection. You can recall the times when Jesus said in exasperation, "Can't you hear what I'm saying to you? Are you deaf? Listen to my words. Listen to the things that I am doing. You will see that I have such love." He came and he showed love. He came and he healed people. He came and he rose people from the dead. He performed miracles that are even not even recorded in Scripture because there wasn't enough room, they figure, for all this world, for all the books that would be written about him. And then they crucified him on the cross. And in his humanness, you know, he must have hurt. It must have broke his heart. But in his divine nature, he focused on saving us from our own hostility. He became a flower in the cow pie. He had a purpose that he was focused on, that he was driven towards. And you know what? So do we. We too, as we focus on Jesus, as we live our lives with purpose because of what Jesus did for us, as he laid it out for us in Scripture for all of us to learn from, we can live through the cow patties of life. And with that in mind, notice also from the text, it says that Jesus is the light of the world. Now, imagine Jesus came to the cow pie of this world that was once so very beautiful and said that it was very good. It had now fallen and become one big cow pile, and he brings hope. He brings the light of hope. In Christ now, we all have the hope of glory. The opportunity is there for all of us to confess our sins and be in glory with the Father one day. The hope of the forgiveness of our sins, the hope of the fellowship we have within the body of Christ. You ever mess up, do something that embarrassed yourself? You ever do something where you had to apologize? My goodness, I've lost track of all the times I've embarrassed myself. I do a really good job of it. I can't tell you how many times I've had to apologize to somebody. Can't tell you how many times I've even had to apologize to my kids at times in life for things I have said. I've had a lot of cow pie in my own face, more often than I'd like to admit. But one thing I have learned, folks, when you apologize, boy, does it ever lift a burden off your shoulders. There is such freedom, there is such blessing, there is such joy that is found in forgiveness. You know, hell is not intended to be a place for human beings. It was only intended for the devil and his angels. Heaven is open. Jesus' invitation is for all people to come to him and have salvation through Jesus Christ. Jesus is God's light in this to this world. He broke into human history so that the sole purpose of saving humanity. He wants to give us hope. Consider what he did here on this earth, and I mentioned these already. He healed the sick, he raised the dead, he forgave sins, and by the way, only God can forgive sins, we know. He preached, he loved, he fed people. He was light to this broken world. And so why should we be light? Because Jesus showed us how to be light. The story is told of a little girl who was shivering her way along Main Street in some particular city. And seeing the beautiful lights of the church building and hearing the music coming from within, she went inside herself to listen and to be warmed. And the preacher's text was, "I am the light of the world." And at the close of the service, she went to the minister and said, "Did you say you are the light of the world, sir?" The minister replied, "No, dear child, Jesus is the light of the world, and I am one of those lights." The little girl looked at him for a moment and then solemnly said, "Well, sir, I wish you would come down to our lane and hang out in our alley, because it is awful dark down there." Christians are indeed, as the Master said, a light into this world. We are a light to this world. And as lights in this world, are we hanging out in the dark alleys of this life? I think in our church we're doing a pretty darn good job. Let me remind you of something. Last week, we had the privilege of handing out 13 food hamper boxes. 13, folks. That's great. I wish you could have seen the thanks in some of the faces of some of the people. You know, if many of their problems are self-induced, and some of them are, for them, they don't see it that way. They see they are in a hopeless condition. And we as a church have been a light to them in the midst of a dark time. I had one lady stop by the church this week who wanted to say thank you. She said, "I didn't want to send a card because it seemed so impersonal. I wanted to stop by and say thank you myself." So she stopped by to say thank you. So I pass that on to each of you, because you were part of that. You were light to that home for that family. And you are light to everywhere you go during the day, your workplaces. You are a light when you go to Tim Hortons and chat it up with the guys and solve the world's problems. In so many places, we are light for the Lord Jesus Christ wherever we go. We are light because Jesus was first light and showed us how to do it. And you can bring light to someone's life in a catapulty. Patties of life. And the last thing I want to draw to our attention is in verse 14. It says Jesus was full of grace and truth. This is such an important teaching. And John contrasts it in verse 17 with the law. We know that living under the law required sacrifices. And these sacrifices were constant. And they lived in the law. They lived the life of do's and don'ts. And it was all about that. Why do we not live under the law? Because Jesus has broken the bonds of the law. Jesus healed on the Sabbath against the law. Jesus walked on the Sabbath against the law court, apparently. He wasn't, because he weren't allowed to. Jesus talked with women, which he shouldn't have done. Jesus talked with the Samaritans. He picked grain on the Sabbath. Jesus showed and lived in grace, and now you and I ought to do the same. I hope you have learned from me, and I hope for some of you are not offended by this, but I don't stand up here on Sundays to tell you you shouldn't do things. Shouldn't drink, shouldn't play cards, shouldn't go to movies, shouldn't do this, shouldn't do that. But as I say that, as I don't condemn those things, there does have a bit of a caveat attached to it from Scripture. 2 Corinthians 6:12 says, everything is permissible for me, but not everything is helpful. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be brought under the control of anything. Titus says, this saying is trustworthy. I want you to insist on these things so that those who have believed in God might be careful to devote themselves to good works. These are good and profitable for everyone. Folks, as we devote, that's the key word, devote ourselves to God, I am more than confident that God can speak to you about those issues. I don't need to. Good philosophy is, if Jesus wouldn't do it, you shouldn't either. If Jesus wouldn't tell that off-color joke, you shouldn't tell that off-color joke either. But you know what? The don'ts don't need to be the focus of our lives. Devotion to Christ should be. The blessings we have in Jesus is we can walk in grace and love and freedom and liberty. As God changes our character, you know, I say that to you all the time, and one of the reasons why is that God really had to change me as a person. And I see the blessings of it, and God is in the character changing business, and we can have joy and freedom as God changes and molds our lives more into His image. When we are living for Jesus, it's amazing how much the do's and don'ts of life become so unimportant and irrelevant in your life, because we want to please God in all that we do. Life is full of cow patties, isn't it? But because of Jesus, we can all bloom through that cow patty. We can see the beauty in the midst of the ugly. We can see God's grace and love in the midst of life difficulties. So many people say that because we as Christians say that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but by Him, that Christianity is therefore exclusive. But the invitation is for everybody. Nice people, I'm afraid, are going to be in hell. That is true. But Christ's love is offered to the world, to every single human being, free of charge. And if, my friends, we choose to ignore and reject God here on this earth, why in God's green earth would you think you would want to spend eternity in His presence? Jesus came at Christmas time, and that is God reaching down to us. He was the light of the world as an example for us to follow, and He lived with such grace and love as an example for us to live by, to take the bonds of the law off of our shoulders. So this morning, do you know this Jesus of Christmas? Jesus wants to change your life. I'm not saying that we pray a prayer and then suddenly we got our ticket to heaven and my goodness, I can live any way I want from here on out because I got my ticket for heaven, because all is good. No, Jesus wants to change your life. He wants you to be a different person a year from now when we sit here again, the Sunday before Christmas. But Jesus will not force himself upon you or anybody else. But the invitation is there for you to come to Jesus. He is the reason we celebrate Christmas, the gift of God. The gift of God for this broken world. What has become a cow pie, Patty, God has made beautiful again through Jesus Christ. You have been made beautiful because you are made in the image of God, each and every one of us. Jesus, the Christmas child, came so that we can spend eternity in glory with the Father, and that is God's wish for every one of us here. Every one of us. For some of us today, life might be difficult. You are currently living in a cow patty, we might say. But as Jesus was our example, we can bloom in the midst of the cow patty of life. Jesus left his glory to take on human flesh. And he bloomed where he was planted as an example for us to live by. We too need to bloom where we're planted. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, for coming to this earth 2,000 years ago plus, that you came to save us, and that the invitation for salvation is free for everyone in trust and reliance and confession of our sins to you. Oh Lord, I pray that there won't be a single person who will leave here this morning who will not confess their sins before you and accept Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, which he truly is. And may we indeed see Christmas with new eyes. And help us to be the light as we go forth from here and be gracious and loving and merciful people to those around us. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we'll invite the worship team forward.
Sure.
this church and Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.